Our first piece is Behold and See If There Be Any Sorrow, But Thou Didst Not Leave His Soul in Hell, by George Friedrich Handel. George Friedrich Handel, born 1605 in Saxony, Germany, learned music at a rather young age against his father's wishes. After attempting to study law at the University of Halle, he had decided to continue his path with music and eventually began working as the organist for the Reformed Cathedral of Halle, eventually leaving this for a violin spot at the opera house within Hamburg. After some success, he eventually traveled to Italy until 1710. After gaining great fame and success in Italy, he was appointed the Kapellmeister of Hanover, who would eventually become King George I. Eventually, he would move to London, and while there, Handel began to work as the master of the orchestra for the Royal Academy of Music. Eventually, though, with the dislike of Italian operas in London becoming more apparent, Handel decided to leave the Academy and form a new company, the New Royal Academy of Music. Eventually, though, he would switch altogether from doing opera to doing oratorios. Similar to operas, oratorios differ in two ways. The first being is that they are not a non-staged piece, and the second is that they are traditionally more sacred. In 1742, Handel would premiere his most famous oratorio, Messiah. Behold takes place from Lamentations 1:12, which states, "Is it nothing to you, all who pass by? Look and see if there be any sorrow like my sorrow, which was brought upon me, which the Lord inflicted on the day of his fierce anger."
Thy rebuke hath broken his heart. He is full of heaviness. He is full of heaviness. Thy rebuke hath broken his heart. He looked for some to have pity on him, but there was no man, neither found he any to comfort him. He looked for some to have pity on him, but there was no man, neither found he any to comfort him.
Thank you.
cleave. He's
October 10, 1813, in the community of Le Rancole, Giuseppe lived in a loving environment and eventually moved to Busseto at an early age and began to study musical composition. Eventually, he would find a job as an organist and a conductor for the Philharmonic Society. While he began writing operas in 1838, with Oberto being his first, his most well-known were Rigoletto, Il Trovatore, and La Traviata. Rigoletto takes place in Mantua, Italy during the 16th century. It tells the story of Rigoletto, a hunchback that finds the Duke of Mantua's good grace after passing himself off as a comedian using his harsh words. He's eventually cursed by Count Monroe after he began to poke fun at his wife. Soon enough, the curse begins to take place. Eventually, it grows bad enough that he hires an assassin he met to kill the Duke and eventually kills Rigoletto's daughter, Gilda, due to a mishap. From Rigoletto, this piece takes place from the Duke's perspective as he talks about women, how women are always fickle and can never make up their mind, always swapping from one idea to the next.
Sempre un amabile, leggiadro viso, in bianco.
Donizetti, born November 29, 1797 in Bergamo. Donizetti was most known for his lifestyle of bel canto style operas. While in his lifetime writing almost 70 operas, his most well-known were being Lucia di Lammermoor, La Fila du Regiment, and La Favorite. He spent the majority of his life in Italy, where he wrote the majority of his work. He worked in Naples until about 1838, when he decided to work in Paris until his body began to break down and he was forced to move home. While in his lifetime, he was a renowned opera composer who would unfortunately fall out of the eye of public after his death as Giuseppe Verdi and Richard Wagner began to take the scene by storm. Written for a friend's daughter, Amiamo is a lighthearted piece about loving no matter what. That all the pleasures in life should always be treasured, and that you should always enjoy what you have before life hits you and becomes boring.
Passa, passa, passa.
Up next, we have In der Fremde by Robert Schumann. Born 1810 in Saxony, Germany, Schumann began his musical journey at the age of 6 when he started learning piano. Being heavily influenced by Franz Schubert and the poetic works of Jean-Paul Richter, while writing a lot of pieces for instrumental, specifically for his wife Clara, he has written his fair share of Lieder with Myrthen, Liederkreis, and Freudenleben und Leben. Even having his first symphony performed by Felix Mendelssohn, eventually he would begin to have oral troubles, which would cause him in a depressive and suicidal state, where he would eventually pass it in 1856. Written in May 1840, this piece is the first in the song cycle Liederkreis, which uses a series of poems written by Joseph von Eichendorff. This specific piece talks about a man who has lost both his parents and family, and how no one back home remembers him, and how he soon will die and will be forgotten as well. Up next, we have Der Musikant by Hugo Wolf. Born March 13, 1860 in Austria, Wolf studied at the Vienna Conservatory until 1877, when he was expelled due to his temperament. During this time, and shortly after, he met famous composers such as Richard Wagner and Johannes Brahms, and was even friends with Gustav Mahler. While Wolf was known due to his more well-off colleague, Wolf himself never saw as much success and often relied on his friends just to have basic necessities. Later in his life, he would write the Eichendorff song cycle along with the Murke song. Part of the Eichendorff song cycle, named after Joseph von Eichendorff, Der Musikant is the second of 20 songs. This song tells the story of a roaming musician who absolutely loves their life. From not knowing where they'll sleep to how bitter the cold would be, how it never affects him. Except, of course, the amount of women who are attracted to this lifestyle. While he may never be tied down to anything, he never wants to be tied down, because he is convinced that if he does, his life will be ruined.
Ich mir doch Mühe geben.
next, we have Der Kuss by Ludwig van Beethoven. Born December 17, 1770, Beethoven was argued as one of the most influential composers to exist. While mostly known for his instrumental music, there were quite a number of choral pieces that saw a great amount of success, such as Missa Solemnis, the Mass in C Major, even Auld Lang Syne. His early life was spent by his father trying to turn him into a prodigy, but unfortunately, it would not come to fruition. Written in 1798, but not published until 1825, Der Kuss offers itself as a lighthearted, if not more off-putting tale in today's time. Christian Felix Weiss's poem offers us a story of the narrator and Chloe. Now, the narrator very much wishes to kiss Chloe, but she doesn't want to. No. She says that if he tries, she will scream. But overcome with desire, he kisses her anyway. And does she scream? Of course she does. But not until long, 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 long after.
Ihr Dog, sie sprach, sie werde schreien. Es sei vergebne mi. Es sei vergebne mi. Ich wachte doch. Und küsste sie, trotz ihrer Gegenwehr. Und schrie sie nicht. Jawohl, sie schrie.
We have A Prayer on the River by Gabriel Fauré. Born May 12, 1845, Fauré learned music from an early age after being discovered by Louis Niedermayer and was made his pupil. In 1896, he became the organist at the church in La Medellin and professor of composition at the Paris Conservatory until 1905, when he became the director of the conservatory. While there, his style would influence 20th century French pieces. In 1920, he would be forced to retire due to illness. His most well-known pieces were Requiem, Pavane, and Nocturne, written with Romain Boussin, this piece is the first of the Trois Melodies. This tells the tale of a person dreaming about their lost lover, being able to see them and flying to the heavens. It seems a paradise for them until they eventually awaken, only to desire sleep once more.
It's on the
Up next, we have Sing Ye a Joyful Song and Hear My Prayer, O Lord, by Antonin Dvorak. Born September 8, 1841, in what is now the Czech Republic, he would enroll in the Institute of Church Music in Prague. In 1875, he would receive a grant that would allow him to meet Johannes Brahms, where they would form a deep and fruitful friendship. Along with advice from Brahms, he had also put him in contact with a well-known publisher, Fritz Simrock. With these things at his side, Dvorak became rather popular in his home country and eventually made the first 10 trips to England, along with finding success in Moscow. Eventually, he would be invited to the United States in 1891 to work as the director of the National Conservatory in New York. During this time, Dvorak began to travel the country and began to write the biblical songs in 1893. While well-liked by the people, the critics would claim that he lacked invention. He would stay in the U.S. until eventually moved back home in 1894. Hear My Prayer, O Lord, takes the text from Psalm 61, while singing a joyful song, offers accompaniment to Psalm 98, verses 1 through 8, and Psalm 96.
And let all the trees of the forest
And finally, we have When First My Old Love I Knew by Gilbert and Sullivan. William Gilbert and Arthur Sullivan began their partnership in 1871 with the production of Thespis. While this was mildly successful, it wouldn't spark the duo to work together until they came together again for Trial by Jury, which saw massive success. Unfortunately, the pair would be hired full-time by Richard Cardiff, and they all saw large successes, but none more than Cardiff. All of them would eventually become massively popular, even rivaling Handel's Messiah and the works of Shakespeare. Sullivan also wrote incidental music for Shakespeare during this time, while Gilbert was credited for slowly losing his creativity. Eventually, things would take a turn for the worse when the duo split due to creative differences. This would be bad enough that Gilbert would actually go on to sue the other two in what was known as the Carpet Quarrel. First produced March 25th, 1875, when First Mile would take place within the comedic opera Trial by Jury. Within this piece, we see the defendant who gives his statement for why he wants to end his engagement for a new lover. The problem with this being that it was a massive issue during the time and led to hefty fines for him. As he pleads his case, he continues to appeal to youth and seemingly hints that the jury should pity him, even though the prosecutor was heartbroken.
When first my old love I knew, my bosom welled with joy. My riches at her feet I threw, I was a lovesick boy. No turn seemed too extravagant upon her to employ. I used to mope and sigh and pant, just like a lovesick boy.
Tink-a-tank, tink-a-tank, tink-a-tank. Tink-a-tank, tink-a-tank, tink-a-tank.
I used to mope and sigh and pine, just like a lovesick boy. But joy incessant pulsed the sense, and love unchangeful glory. And she became a bore intent unto her lovesick boy. With fitful glimmer burnt my flame, and I grew cold and coy. At last one morning I became another's lovesick boy.
Take a tank, 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 take a tank.